When we build apps in Nocode, very often we're relying on our users to enter new data. In this case, we very often will want to leverage a form. And how awesome is it if you can have the form built directly in the software that you're using to build your application? Well, in this video, I'm going to be breaking down how robust the forms are in one of my favorite front-end tools, Noloco. So if learning about this is of interest to you, stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth, and this is Gap Consulting. We make it our mission to help you get the most out of no-code tools. One of our favorite tools, of course, being Noloco that we're going to be covering here in this video. But before we get into the heart of the video, I first want to invite you to join me for some training. If you're kind of new to no-code, you are going to love the training I've put together that teaches you the steps of no-code automation. This is going to save you so much time when you understand how to leverage this skill, which is exactly what I'm teaching in the recorded webinar that I'm offering to you for free. You can grab that at gapconsulting.io/webinar-registration, and it's going to teach you the core fundamentals of no-code automation so that you can start reclaiming your time and focusing on the bigger picture. But without further ado, let's hop on into my screen. We're going to start with our backend database. Not a lot of explaining to do here. I've actually showcased this in previous videos. My data is living in Airtable, and this is actually a live backend database that supports all of our video production here at Gap Consulting. So at a high level, I'm looking at the different tables here. I've got my content. Each record in this entire table is another piece of content with all the various assets from the raw files of the video to the thumbnails, to the text, to the SRT files, like all the different components that make up a piece of content live here. Then, of course, this links out to a social media schedule where we publish our different social media posts. We have the different brands that we work with, different brand assets, and then different playlists, calls to action, etc. But the key focus for us here today is really this first table, the content table, because what I want to be able to do is build an application inside of Noloco, and I want to create a new piece of content from within the application. This is a perfect example for when you would use a form. A form is going to help you create a new record or records inside of your application, but add them to a specific table, in this case, my content table. So let's flip on now to inside of the Noloco application. You can see all I've done here is connect that backend data source to Noloco, and then Noloco, in its infinite wisdom, has created all the different components for me here. If you're not already familiar, Noloco uses AI to scan your data source and put together what it thinks you're gonna want, and so it's already created all these various pages for me. Now, inside of my content page, remember, I really want to focus just on the records in content. I see here on a calendar what we're working on, and in fact, this very record right here is the video that we're recording right now. So we see that we have this video, this Noloco placeholder, which now has become this video, Noloco Advanced Form Building. So what I want to be able to do, though, is look at a calendar, visualize what we have coming up on our roadmap, but also to be able to click a button and add a new piece of content, create a new video concept, even if just a placeholder, so that we can start planning new content in the future. So this is exactly where forms are going to come into play. I want to add, as I said, a new record to that content table. So in order to do this, we're going to go over here within our content section, and we're going to click on options here. And if we scroll down, we're going to notice that we have the ability to show new record button. This is allowing us to have this button right here, new content, that will allow us to create a new piece of content, a new record. And now we can add text to the button. By default, it is just going to go with no content because we've called that table content. So it's just saying we're going to add a new one. But I could change this. I could say something like add new video. And you see that as I'm typing that, it's changing the button itself. Now, this is the first step, but what we actually want to dive into is the form itself. So now that we have a button that goes to a form, we need to set that form up. And right now you can see that it's saying that this is going to a view called content. We could also send this to a default, and that would be just as fine. But for us, I want to focus on this new view content, which is right in here, create new content. So if we click on the button, it's actually going to take us to the form itself. And this is where we get to mess with stuff. So First and foremost, we have a lot of different data that's being stored inside of our content records. We don't want all of this data up front when we add a new piece of content to the calendar. It wouldn't make sense to have things like the status of the video, right? We obviously know it's going to be in an early status. We don't want to necessarily have the content elements or the frame.io link or all these other things. These are going to be built as the content comes together. When we create a record for the new piece of content, we have a limited amount of information. So for us, we're gonna bring in whatever we need for that stage of the workflow. So we might have a video title, for example. If we scroll all the way up here, you'll see the fields that we have inside of our data source. And these that are toggled on are the fields that are showing up on the form. So we've got things like the video title. That is a field that we're gonna work with, and we can update this title over time. But when we're creating a new piece of content, as you saw on the previous screen, maybe we just have something like Noloco TBD, something of that nature. Now, we also want to bring in the scheduled date. So when we're clicking in here, you'll see that we have the ability to drop down a calendar here. We can add a date and even a time inside of Noloco's date time picker. Similarly, here we have software. Now, you'll notice that our software, if we look at the data source here, it's a linked record. So it's linking to a different data table inside of Airtable. So when we bring this down, we see, oh man, there's a lot of software that we've worked with over the years. These are all records in another table, and we can select one when we are putting together our form. Now, we might also add a playlist. If you recall back on my data source, I was showing you all the different tables. Playlists was a table as well. And this is something where we might say, all right, this is going to be, let's say, a front end, or maybe fill out forms, or no code automation, like whatever playlist we're going to assign this video to when we launch it. If we know that at the time of setting up the form, we can enter it. And then also a call to action. If you remember back at the beginning of this video, I said, hey, check out a free training on the automation webinar. Well, that's right here. I'm indicating to my team when we set this up that we're looking at something in particular for the call to action on each video. So a lot of this goes into the video planning stage, but you'll note that things that we don't have are different fields like when is the draft due? Or if I scroll down here, what is the title for the content or blog? Or what is the blog URL, the blog page? Obviously, we don't have these components. These will come into existence as the content evolves through the various stages of creation. So now let's take a look at what we can do inside of the fields that we've toggled on and selected to appear in our form. If we click on the pencil icon, you're going to see we have quite a few options here. First, we're going to look at the input field tab. So we can change the title here. So I can say, create a working title. And when I make this change, you're going to notice that the way this shows up on the form changes. And I can also add some help text as well. Here, I'm going to say video title here. And I can also include different data components and bring them in here. This doesn't make sense for our particular use case, but it is possible to include things like form values. So if somebody has filled out a previous field on the form, we can bring information in from that answer and fill out other answers on other fields within the form. Also note that we can go to the logged in user here. I can bring in information about the logged in user, bring their name in and fill it out in a field or their profile picture, etc. Lots of options as pertaining to the users who have access to our application. We also have access to relative dates. So for example, with a date field, I could actually use some components in relation to today. So I could say this month at the start of the month or the end of the month. Or let's go back this week at the start of the week or the end of the week. You get the idea. There's elements within the form that I can bring in and start pre-filling information and also include that here in the help text as well. Now, I also have the field width. I can choose how much space this particular field is going to take up on the form. If I come down now to schedule date, let's back up here and go into our next field. And I'll make this 50% as well. You'll notice that it gets moved up here to be included on the same line. Now, do note that if I don't have helper text for the scheduled date, then it's gonna look like these things don't align very well. So let's add some sample text here. And now we're gonna see that our fields line up pretty nicely. Now, I can also, inside of these fields, again, I'm in scheduled date right now. I can add a placeholder here. So I might say something like Jan 1, and you're going to notice that that is placeholding here just as example text to showcase as, you know, what somebody would expect to see when the form is completely filled out. We can also apply a default value. And here again, we're getting those same options, right? The form values, we can take form values from the draft. We can bring in the logged in users values. We can go with a relative date. Like I might say, I'm going to take today's date and plug it in like this moment in time. So as of filming, it's May 25th, 2024 at 1:31 PM. When I access this form by default, it's going to have that value, but then I can update that and change it as needed. We also have utility values here, as you see, values to help with actions. So if you have some kind of workflows and other things that you're tying into this, you can put in some utility values here as well. Now, of course, it's also very important to note where it is inside of your form builder to make a field required. This is adding the asterisk right here. A required field has to be filled out with some data before someone can submit the form. So toggle this on for any information that you absolutely require every time the form is filled out. Also, we have some required when conditions are met. So we can set up a more robust type of requirement. This is actually a really nice field. We could say, for example, I only require a scheduled date to be filled out if someone's put a working title in. But if they haven't put a working title in, I don't require a scheduled date. So this is pretty unique to Noloco's forms. This is one of those capabilities that does not exist natively in many other tools. We can also validate field inputs. So we can set up rules to say certain things have to be true in order to accept this as a valid field value. So we could say it must be equal to something, or in this case, it's a date. It has to be after today's date. We can't create a record for past dates, for example. So we have so many different options here in making sure that we get consistent, accurate data put into our forms in terms of requiring it when conditions are met, and then also validating field inputs. Now, lastly, down here, we have the option to hide this, or rather only show it when specific conditions are met. So for example, we might say, hey, in this case, there must be a value in the video title field. If the video title is not empty, then I want you to show this field. So when I put something here, then and only then will this field appear. Another very robust form feature, giving us even more control over how this is going to show up and how our forms are going to operate. But we haven't gotten to the amazing parts yet. I'm talking about hidden values. So when we flip over here, we can provide a hidden value which hides the input field. In this case, I'm working with the scheduled date. It's hidden from the form. The user will never even see it, but allows you to set some sort of default value. So it's still there on the form. It's still going to capture information, but it will not be showing up on the form for people who are filling it out. And again, we have the same options here, right? The form values, the logged in user data, the relative dates, and the utility values. Also note that throughout this whole time, we've had the option to toggle off a dynamic value, and we can just plug in a static value so that every time this form is filled out, it's going to take the same static value. It won't update depending on what else is happening inside the form. Now, if you want to toggle this off and go back to having a regular field on the form, just simply switch back to input field and we're good to go. Now, one final component that must be highlighted is Noloco allows us to build and publish forms that are external to our web app, meaning we can have our portal, our whole system built in Noloco, our application, and we can lock down who can have access to the app, but then we can publish a public form so that other people who are not logged into our application can submit new data through that form, and we would therefore capture that data and our internal team would be able to review it and access the data accordingly. In order to turn this on, we have to go back to the form options itself. On the way down here, you'll note that we have the high-level form options, including the header. This is where we are putting in the title and a subtitle. I'll just drop this in here so we see what this looks like on the form. Drops in subtitle right here. We have breadcrumbs, which is this component at the top. If I toggle this on or off, we're going to see the ability to navigate using those breadcrumbs. We can add a cover photo if we want. In this case, I'll keep it blank. And then we can change the save button. So I'll say submit data, and you'll notice that the button is changing. On save, we can customize the page that is shown after the record is saved. This is perfect for internal users. After they submit the form, we can send them back to the content page, for example. Just take them on back, go right back to content, that easy. But here's the one I was talking about, the public form. Enabling this on a public form is going to create a on submission message for us that we can then edit. And this is now the URL that we can share with folks. So anyone external to our application can access it if they have that URL and submit data into our application. Now do note that in order for this to work, we have to first publish our app. So we would come back over here and say, yep, let's publish those changes now that I've turned on the public form. It takes just a moment. And now if I copy and paste that URL into a new window, I'm gonna be able to see that information once it loads. And this is now a public URL, does not require anyone to be signed in, and they can enter data right here. This is gonna be Noloco TBD scheduled date. You see it popping up right here. I'm gonna change that date. We'll schedule it for 8 a.m. And I can add the software of Noloco. I can choose a playlist and Nocode Automation, and we can add a call to action. There we go, submit. It looks like we didn't finish spelling data, but you get the point. I know we went really fast in this video, and maybe you have some additional questions that we were not able to cover, so feel free to visit our website and reach out with those if you do have them, or drop them below wherever you found the video. In the meantime, my friend, keep on building.